So how about we start with a prayer, yes? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Lord God, I thank you for this day and this opportunity to learn more about you and your plan for us. I thank you especially for your Son, for sending your Son to take on our flesh, to take on our brokenness, to take on our sin, to take on our wounds and our death. Thank you for the life that he gave. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for giving your life, for sacrificing everything for us. Please help us to believe. Help us to follow you with all our hearts. Help us to change anything in our lives that is not in line with your will for us, your plan for us. We ask all this as we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So as you see, tonight we're going to talk about baptism and confirmation, two of the sacraments that some of you, all of you are preparing at least for confirmation, some of you for baptism. So where are we at? We talked about the truth, right? That we are here to seek the truth. It's not just about what makes us feel nice, but what is actually true. And we've talked about the meaning of life even, this big claim. Have we been created just for this stuff, white picket fence, nice house, fancy car, then you die and it's over? Or have we been created for more? Have we been created for union with God? Have we been created to actually share in the very life of God? We talked about how we can prove that there is one infinite, all-powerful God. We talked about how we know that Jesus Christ is the only Son of God, and how Jesus Christ reveals that this one God is three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the Holy Trinity. One God, three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We talked about how Jesus Christ gives us the fullness of divine revelation. He is the Word of God, and he reveals everything to us, right? Through sacred scripture, through sacred tradition, and he establishes a church, the magisterium, to teach us, to keep us in the truth. Jesus Christ started the Catholic Church. And we talked about if we wish to be saved from eternal death, we have to unite ourselves to Jesus Christ. He is the only one that's ever conquered death. He is the only one that's ever risen from the dead, resurrected, never to die again. And so if I want to conquer death, if I want to be reunited with God, if I want to get to heaven, I got to be with Jesus Christ. And so the question, of course, is how? How do I unite myself with Jesus Christ? How do I experience the power of everything that he did for me? Once I turn to him, once I believe, what do I got to do? What do I got to do to receive all of that, everything that Christ did for us? Okay, so we're going to talk about that tonight. Because the answer ultimately is the sacraments. The sacraments are the way Christ gives us his most powerful graces. So what is a sacrament? Sacrament is an outward sign instituted by Christ to give grace. So outward sign, what does that mean? Now a stop sign is not what I'm talking about. A stop sign won't make you stop, right? A wall will, but a stop sign won't. So an outward sign means a visible reality that signifies something. It points to something. It is a sign. It points to something, right? So the waters of baptism, they point to a cleansing. They're a sign of the cleansing because it's water. It makes you clean. That's what we use. So it's a physical reality that points to something happening, instituted by Christ. Christ gave us the sacraments to give us real grace. Or the compendium to the catechism says, the sacraments instituted by Christ and entrusted to the church are efficacious signs of grace, perceptible to the senses. They're powerful. They do stuff. The sacraments are how Christ encounters us, both in body and soul. We know that Christ took on flesh. He walked around. And he interacted with people through his body. He spoke. You know, he laid his hands on people. He raised the dead. He calmed the storms. He drove out demons. He offered his humanity, including his body, on the cross. And because Christ has wedded himself with human nature, he also gave us the sacraments so that we have these physical realities that are set up by him to give us grace. Right? And this is a great gift so that we don't just have a relationship with Christ like, well, I just believe and I hope he's kind of given me grace. I don't really know for sure. I kind of feel it, right? That type of religion would be very dangerous. It'd be a dangerous religion of, well, I feel it in my heart that I'm okay. But wait, you're robbing banks and you're doing horrible things. But I feel it in my heart, so I know God's okay with what I'm doing. It's like, wait a second. We can't trust. That's one of the whole problems is people sin because they trust their feelings too much. Right? There's a whole problem with that. So what did Jesus do? He set us up a visible church that says, hey, no, you're understanding that wrong. Come back. Come back. You're gone off the deep end here. Well, I just feel in my heart that it's okay to live with my boyfriend. I'm sorry, that's not what Jesus said. But I feel he's okay with it. Your feelings are not God. Like, people can have feelings that are wrong. You know, that's how sin happens. So he sets up a visible church, the Catholic Church, gives us his word and scripture and tradition. And he wants us also to know when we're receiving grace, that it's not just going to be this emotional thing, because grace is something supernatural. And we don't want to just live based on the level of feelings, especially with supernatural things. So he sets up the sacraments, right? I mean, you see in the scriptures, at times, like he heals a blind man. He takes mud, he takes dirt on the ground, spits on it, makes mud and puts it on a guy's face, puts it on a guy's eyes and says, go wash in the pool of Siloam. Very visual. Does Jesus need to do that? He didn't need to do anything. He could have just been like, he didn't even need to snap his fingers. He could have just willed it and the guy would have been healed. But he chose to do something physical. It's a physical thing, put mud on the guy's eyes, go wash in the pool of Siloam, go wash with water, because he's pointing to baptism. He's pointing to a greater reality there. So there are seven sacraments that Christ has given to us, and we're going to talk about them. Baptism, the first sacrament that we receive, the doorway to all the sacraments. Reconciliation or confession, where we go to our priests and confess our sins and we receive that forgiveness because we believe Christ has given priests the power to forgive sins. It's not just, oh, I'm going to go tell Father my sins because, you know, got to tell somebody. No, we go because we believe that Jesus Christ gave the priests the power to do something that just telling anybody else, you know, it's not just write it on Twitter or Instagram or Facebook. No, we go because that the priest has the power to forgive sins. Holy Communion and the Blessed Eucharist, Confirmation, which we're going to talk about tonight too, marriage, holy orders called sacraments of service, and the anointing of the sick to prepare the soul for death, to offer all the sufferings. We're going to talk about these. So, three sacraments, baptism, Holy Communion, and Confirmation, are called sacraments of initiation. They're the sacraments that make us Catholic, that bring us into Catholic life. Of course, baptism, we know this. We're going to talk about Confirmation, Holy Communion. We'll talk about next time. Reconciliation or confession and anointing of the sick are called sacraments of healing. They bring a spiritual healing to the soul, to bring forgiveness of sins, to bring a healing of the soul, to be able to offer all of our sufferings to God. Marriage and holy orders are called sacraments of service, a vocation, a calling to lay down their lives, either for their spouse and their children or for the church. It's important, when we talk about marriage, it's important to remember, marriage is not a sacrament of selfishness like most people think today. I take you to be my husband as long as you promise to make me happy all the days of your life. Or, you know, I take you to be my wife as long as you promise to make me happy all the days of your life. Right? A lot of people are going into marriage like that, thinking that I'm marrying them and it's your responsibility now to make me happy. And so if I'm not happy, it's your fault. It's like, wow, that is really selfish. That is really self-absorbed. You don't get married so that someone else is going to make you happy. That's all for you. It's not about that. If you're not already happy going in to the relationship, then you're just using the person for your own selfish happiness. I'm lonely. I need a spouse. No, you need Jesus Christ. You need God. So we'll talk about all that. It's a sacrament of service, right? That's how it works when people have this idea. I'm laying down my life, and it works. Okay, so what makes something a sacrament? So kind of break down the definition. First, there's a form. There's a way of going about it. There's the word spoken. Like, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. So if I got all the faith in the world, I love Jesus Christ, and I take water and I say, I baptize you in this name of Jesus, Mary, and Joseph. Is that kid baptized? No, kid's not baptized. It's got to be as Jesus told us. Jesus said, I baptize you. Go make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I've commanded you, and behold, I'm with you always until the end of the age. So the word spoken. There's the matter. What's the matter? No. The visible material reality. So what is the matter with baptism? Nothing's the matter with baptism, Father. That's great. No. What is the material visible reality of baptism? What's the physical stuff that we use in baptism? Starts with a W, ends with an otter. Water. Here we go. All right. Water. So if I use coffee, is that kid baptized? I have real strong faith, and coffee was all that was available to me. Is the kid baptized? No. Jesus didn't say it's okay to use coffee. He said, water, baptize. The word baptism implies water. And because coffee can't signify, it can't point to a cleansing. We use bread and wine in the Eucharist. Do you ever think about why we use bread and wine in the Eucharist? Why not rice cakes and 7-Up? Why not water? Bread and wine, there's something that it's pointing to. Jesus, one, we use bread and wine because Jesus used bread and wine. That's number one. But why did Jesus use bread and wine? One of the reasons is how bread and wine is made. How is bread made? By the wheat being crushed. How is the wine made? By the grapes being crushed, right? How does our salvation happen? Christ is crushed by our sins. And so it's pointing to a reality here. The Eucharist, we're receiving Jesus. Jesus was crushed. He was crucified for us. He laid down his life for us. Okay. Of course, it has to be instituted by Christ. The church cannot create sacraments. Oh, if the Pope says, today I think I'm going to create the 8th sacrament called whatever. I don't know, whatever. Nope. It has to be instituted by Christ and entrusted to the church. By the power of the Holy Spirit, it's given to the church and entrusted to certain people. So certain people can perform certain sacraments. And it's all, of course, by the power of the Holy Spirit that's been given to the church at Pentecost. Okay, so looking at baptism. What does baptism do? First, we see Jesus first talks about baptism in John chapter 3, verse 5. Now, John the Baptist, before this, had been on the scene and he'd been baptizing people. But it wasn't the same type of baptism that we have now. It was a baptism of repentance to prepare the way. So if someone was baptized by John the Baptist, it didn't do what, they still weren't baptized. And we see this in the Acts of the Apostles, where people are like, no, we only got baptized by John. Like, okay, we got to fix this. He was preparing the way. But Jesus, I'm going to read the story for you in chapter 3. Now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. Jesus answered him, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born anew, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus said to him, how can a man be born when he's old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of flesh is flesh, that which is born of spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I say to you, you must be born anew. The wind blows where it wills, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know whence it comes or whither it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit." We're going to see Jesus, when he sends out the apostles, he says in Mark 16, "Go out into all the world and preach the gospel to the whole creation. He who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned." Jesus didn't just say, "Oh, you just need to believe in me." He would have just said, "He who believes in me will be saved." No, he who believes and is baptized. Once we have faith, what do we got to do? We need to be baptized. And why? Because it actually does something. It's not just a merit badge of I believed, I accept Jesus as Lord, and so, bam, all that grace comes to me. No, that grace comes to me through the sacrament of baptism. In Romans chapter 6, it says this. "What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin still live in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life." So it's by baptism that we die with him and rise with him. This is what it's saying. We were baptized into Christ Jesus. We're baptized into his death. We were buried with him, therefore, by baptism. In Colossians 2, in Colossians chapter 2, verses 11 through 12, it says, "In him also you were circumcised with a circumcision made without hands, by putting off the body of flesh in the circumcision of Christ. And you were buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through faith in the working of God, who raised him from the dead." So, you know, in the Old Testament, when someone wanted to be part of the covenant, ever since the time of Abraham, they had to be circumcised. The guys had to be circumcised, which I'm guessing, guys, you know what that means, right? It's pretty graphic reality there. And what's St. Paul talking about? He's saying baptism is the new circumcision. You want to be part of the covenant? You want to experience the benefits of the covenant? You got to have this new circumcision, baptism. In 1 Peter chapter 3, verse Peter chapter 3, verse 20 and 21. Now, he's going through he's talking about the flood. For Christ also died for sins, once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God. Being put to death in the flesh, he was made alive in the Spirit, in which he went and preached to the spirits in prison, whom formerly did not obey, when God's patience waited in the days of Noah, during the building of the ark, in which eight persons were saved through water. So he's drawing a parallel. They were saved through water at the flood. Baptism, which corresponds to this, now saves you, not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a clear conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God with angels and authorities and powers subject to him. And so baptism, it doesn't say baptism is a sign of the salvation you once received days, weeks, months, years ago when you believed. No, baptism now saves you. It does something. The waters go over your head. The words that Christ gave us, grace comes to the soul. So what grace? What are the effects of baptism? First, one of the effects of baptism is the forgiveness of sin. All sin, both original sin and personal sin. Now, Who can remember, what is original sin? If someone says to you, what are you talking about? What is original sin? What are you going to say? Original sin is the loss of sanctifying grace, is being born without the grace of salvation dwelling in our soul. It's the empty chalice, right? We're made in the image of God. Adam and Eve had grace, divine life, the grace of salvation, sanctifying grace dwelling in their soul, which gave them a real communion with God. And they, when they sinned, they lost that. And we are born without it. Original sin is the loss of divine life, the loss of sanctifying grace, the loss of the grace of salvation, the loss of what you have to have if you ever want to get to heaven. What is original sin? The loss of the grace of salvation, being born without the grace of salvation. However you want to say it, that's what it is. So when we say that brings the forgiveness of sins, forgives original sin, it doesn't just mean, oh, you have got original sin, it's gone. No, it means grace is filling your soul. The grace of salvation is coming into your soul. You know, it's so important that we have a Catholic understanding that sin is not just this checklist. Okay, God's got his laundry list of all the stuff, and when you get forgiven, he erases it. No, it changes you. It makes you new. He lives in your soul. Through serious sin, he doesn't live in your soul. He'll hold you in existence out of love. He holds the devil in existence. But we don't live with him. We've been separated from him. He's not giving us life. But when we're forgiven of our mortal sins, we're forgiven of original sin, he brings, what forgiveness is a restoration of communion. He lives inside of us. And that makes us a new creation. Makes us a child of God. When we are baptized, we experience the power of everything Jesus did on the cross. And it doesn't just change us at a distance. It unites us to Jesus Christ, makes us part of Jesus Christ, makes us a member of his body. Jesus shares his very sonship with us, and it changes us. It changes us, made new. And Jesus says this in the book of Revelation, behold, I make all things new. He doesn't want to just make you his disciples. He wants to put you to death and bring you to life. Put the old person of sin to death and bring a new creation about, a new life. He makes us temples of the Holy Spirit. Temples of the Holy Spirit. Members of the kingdom of God. And when we say temples of the Holy Spirit, now wherever the Holy Spirit is, there's the Father and the Son. And so we talk about the indwelling of the Trinity. God is actually able to dwell in our soul. The infinite, all-powerful God changes our soul so he can live inside of us, which is something we did not have before baptism. God can actually live inside of us. We become members of the kingdom of God, the church. We're given this new identity. So, and this is so important that we take this to heart and let it hit us, let it knock us over, let it affect us. And we think, do I believe this? If you've been baptized, do you believe this? Do you believe at the core of who you are is not just some person who was born in the United States or born in Mexico or just some person who likes video games or likes television or has this job, right? Our culture is great at defining by externals, right? What do you do for a living? You know, well, I'm a computer programmer, or I'm an engineer, right? No, what do I do for a living? what do I do for a living? Love Jesus Christ and receive his grace. That's what I do for a living. What do I do to make money? Well, that's a different thing. Who am I? Who are you? A beloved child of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, a member of the kingdom of God, a temple of the Holy Spirit. Do you see yourself as more sacred as a chalice, more valuable than a church? We are God's dwelling. We are a place where God wants to dwell. And this is what happens at baptism. It changes us. And we receive an indelible mark You can't undo your baptism. You can't get baptized multiple times. You can't undo your baptism. You can reject the grace. You can pour out the chalice, so to speak. But that mark is there. It's changed. Your soul is changed. In heaven, we will see, be able to see, yep, that person's been baptized. That person was baptized and confirmed. You know, that person's baptized, confirmed, and is a priest. That person's a bishop, too. So, be able to see the change there to the soul. Okay, so practical stuff. Who is the minister of baptism? A bishop, priest, or deacon is the ordinary minister of baptism. Now, in an emergency, actually, this is one of the sacraments that in an emergency, anybody can baptize. As long as they do it right. They say the right words, they have the right intention to baptize the person, and they use water. So if someone's, big car accident and some random person walks up and, you know, has got their little Colorado water bottle with them, and like, the person's dying, and, you know, the priest isn't going to get here in time. He needs to be baptized. Okay, all right. I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Baptism. Again, the ordinary way, because baptism is part of the church, is, you know, bring them to church. You know, if they're babies, I'm baptized at the church. Of course, those who are preparing, you're going through classes to prepare. But technically, in an emergency, anyone can. How? Again, this is the form and the matter. To pour water over a person's head 3 times or immerse them 3 times, dunk them. I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Boom, that person's baptized. And because it makes you a new creation, it changes you. There's promises that people are making when they get baptized. Russ, would you close that? Never mind, I'll just do it. Okay. So you get asked when you get baptized because it is a change of life. This is not just something you do because this is part of my culture and this is what Catholics do. And I don't really know how much I believe it, but, you know, it's part of my culture. So that's what I'm going to do. No, this is more important, more life-changing than a wedding, more important, more life-changing than having children. This is an entire way of existing. Are you willing to live this way? It has to be total. If you're not willing to totally embrace it, you're not ready. You're not ready for the sacrament. So do you reject Satan and all his works and all his empty promises? And I think it's important that the church has his works and his empty promises there. It's not just, do you reject Satan? You know, I think most people on the planet, if Satan appeared and he's like his pitchfork and his horns, like, I'm Satan, come follow me. People are like, nah. But all his empty promises, hey, you know, you won't die if you do this. Nothing bad's going to happen. Come on, over here. You don't need to go to church. Come on. Yo, it's okay to down a few more. It's okay to do this with your girlfriend. It's okay to look at that thing. Those are empty promises that sin somehow brings life. All his works, the works of sin and disobedience. Do you reject it? Do you say, I don't want to sin ever again. I want to be faithful. Now we may struggle and fall at times, but do we want to be faithful? Are we ready to say, I want to be holy, I want to be a saint. I don't want to sin ever again. Do you believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth? This is where that faith comes in. Not just do we believe that he exists. Do you believe? Do you believe in him? Do you entrust everything to him? Is he everything? Is he God to you? Or is he 911? Is he the hour a week guy who bails you out? Or is he everything? Lord, King, the one we follow, the one we offer everything to, the one we live for, the one who determines everything. Is he God? Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was born of the Virgin Mary, was crucified under Pontius Pilate, suffered, died, and was buried, who rose from the dead, ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father? Do we believe everything that Jesus did? Do we believe in him? Do we trust him? Do we place our faith in him? Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting? And we say this creed, we say a form of this creed every Sunday. And before someone's baptized, they're embracing everything, right? I can't remember if I told this story before, but so there was a lady who wanted to have her kid baptized, but they weren't going to church. And so the lady who was doing the work with the baptism families and stuff was like, "Father, will you come talk to them? Because I just don't think I'm getting through to them." And I was like, okay, I'll give it a shot, you know, whatever. And so I sat down with them, and, you know, I tried to explain, like, you know, when someone's baptized, you promise that you're going to bring them up in the faith. "Oh, we will. We'll bring them up in the faith. We'll raise them." "Well, but what does that mean? You're going to raise them to just believe in God? Well, that's not Catholicism. That's not all of Catholicism, to just think that God exists. That's deism, you know, just thinking God exists. Like, if that's your religion, then that's not Catholicism, that's deism. Well, we'll teach them to believe in Jesus." "Okay, well, that's not all of Catholicism. There's more to Catholicism. That's part of Catholicism. When you say, but you're going to get asked, do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting? Do you believe in all of it?" Right? Baptism makes you a member of the Catholic Church, not this part of the church that you think is okay, but all of it, totality. That's what Catholic means, of the whole thing. And I said, so you can understand why, you know, we as Catholics have to go to church. That this is the sacrifice of the Mass. This is the central act of worship for us. This is part and parcel of what it means to be Catholic. What it means, and when someone's baptized, they're made a member of the church. And she said it to me at that point, "I don't want them to have anything to do with the church. I just want them baptized." I was like, so it sounds like what you want is you want me to deny everything I believe about the sacrament of baptism and just go according to your religion, go according to your beliefs. And I can't do that. That's a betrayal. I think this makes them a member of the church. You're trying to say, "No, I just want them baptized into what I think it is." No, you're asking me to deny my faith. I can't do this. And so I said, "I'm telling you, you got to start coming to church if you want to get your kid baptized. You got to, like, be Catholic." And she got upset. She said, "Are you telling me I need to change? Are you telling me I need to change?" I was like, "Yeah." She's like, "How dare you? How dare you tell me I need to change? I've been Catholic all my life. How dare you?" I'm like, "Ma'am, I'm a priest. I tell everybody they need to change." Like, what is this? She got up. She stormed out of the office and never saw her again. I'm like, what is that? That's not, I don't know what's going on with that lady. But that's not what this is about. It's not just some special ceremony, have some pictures. This is a changing of your existence. A changing of your existence. That's what we believe. So, is baptism necessary for salvation? What do you think? The short answer is yes. So the Catechism says, the Lord himself affirms that baptism is necessary for salvation, right? Where did he say that? He said, unless you are born of water and spirit, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. Unless you're born of water and spirit. He also commands his disciples to proclaim the gospel to all nations and to baptize them. Baptism is necessary for salvation for those whom the gospel has been proclaimed and who have had the possibility of asking for the sacrament. And so once we hear Christ, once we hear about Christ, once we hear about the sacrament of baptism, once it hits us, like, this is the way, and we have the possibility of actually asking for it, we've got to be baptized. So, the church does not know of any other means other than baptism that assures entry into eternal beatitude. This is why she takes care not to neglect the mission she has received from the Lord, to see that all who can be baptized are reborn of water and the Spirit. God has bound salvation to the sacrament of baptism, but he himself is not bound by his sacraments. And that's an important part. So the church says, this is the way that Christ set up. We know that this is the sure way. You want to get salvation? Repentance, faith, and baptism. That's the sure way that Christ has given us. He who believes and is baptized will be saved. But then we can ask the question, okay, Father, what about somebody in 40 AD in North America? They have no possibility of hearing about Jesus Christ, no possibility of being baptized. Is it possible for them to get to heaven, or is that it? They're just doomed. Sorry, kid, you're born in North America in 40 AD. You're just going to burn. There's no way for you to get to heaven. And this is where the church says, God has bound salvation to the sacrament of baptism, right? We know it brings salvation, but he himself is not bound by his sacraments. He can work outside of them. So we have, he who believes and is baptized will be saved. He who does not believe will be condemned. So faith leads to repentance, to repent of our sins. We have to do what Jesus said, which gets to be baptized, and that then leads to a life of grace. Jesus said, unless one is born of water and spirit, it cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. 1 Peter, baptism which corresponds to this now saves you, right? It brings that grace. Okay. So we'll cover some specific questions with that. Come back to that for a second. So why do we baptize infants then? Why don't we wait until they're older? A baby can't repent. Can a baby have faith? Because we know that salvation is a grace, it is a gift. No one ever came to faith without the grace of God. No one can ever say, I believe without any help from you, God, give me the grace. He'd be like, no, you don't. If I didn't give you the grace to believe, you wouldn't even believe. Yes, we have free will and our free will is engaged. God doesn't make us believe against our will, but to repent, to convert, to have faith, there's massive amounts of graces that God's giving to us. And we didn't deserve those graces. It was an undeserved gift that we received. And so, what does the church say? When someone has a child, they don't wait till that child's older until they can talk. When they say, "Oh, do you want food? What type of food do you want?" And I can't really feed you until I know what you want. You know, you don't want to say, "Oh, you want to go to school today? Oh, you don't feel like going to school today? Fine, you don't have to go to school." Anything that's important, the parents are like, "We are smarter than you, 1 year old. We know that you need food, even though you don't want to eat food right now. We know, 5 year old, that you need to start learning stuff and go to school, you know, even though you don't feel like it." So parents provide for the needs of their children long before that child can express the need. And a parent can look at the child and say, "This child's got original sin," what is original sin? The loss of sanctifying grace, being born without sanctifying grace, being born without salvation. This kid needs that grace. My kid needs the salvation of Jesus Christ. So we don't wait. Well, we're going to wait, have them live without the grace of Christ for 12 years. That's not going to go well. Like, they need that grace to help them go towards God. They need that grace, not only to get to heaven, but to live with God rather than to live without that grace. Don't deprive them of divine adoption. Don't deprive them of the covenant. And so the church will say, no, the faith of the parents is sufficient. It's necessary. You can't baptize a child against the will of the parents. I can't just walk around on the street and say, "Hey, kid, have you been baptized?" "No, my parents are Muslim." No, that would be a violence. God's not going to, that kid wouldn't be invalid. That kid wouldn't be baptized. But Jesus said, "Let the children come to me and do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of God." So we don't wait. Just like in the Old Testament, you didn't wait until the kid was 12, 13, 14 to decide, "Hey, do you want to be a part of the covenant? You're going to have to get circumcised." No, at 8 days, kids circumcised, brought them part of the covenant. They want to reject it later, they can, but they have free will. But they're going to grow up in the covenant. And this is the goal. This baptism, which is the new circumcision, they're being brought into the covenant. We see this in the scriptures where when people come to faith, it says whole households converted, presumably including children. And so I put the other passages there. Our Acts 16, where we see whole households coming to being baptized. So now, what about catechumens? So catechumens who die before baptism, their explicit desire to receive it together with repentance for their sins and charity assures them the salvation that they were not able to receive through the sacrament. So someone's in the classes, they say, I do repent of my sins. I do want to live this new life. I do turn away from all these sins for the love of God. And they're seeking baptism, but they got hit by a bus the day before. Tough luck, man, gonna burn. No, the Lord sees their soul, sees their heart, says, okay, there is a sincere repentance, a sincere turning away from sin for the love of God, a sincere desire, and they're being faithful, they're pursuing baptism, so the grace is going to be present. But that doesn't mean, of course, they don't need to get baptized. All I have it is, it'd be nonsense. I have a desire for baptism, that gives me the grace, so I never need to be baptized. What? I have a desire for pizza, but I don't need to eat pizza. What? No, it doesn't make sense. You have a desire for baptism, it means you're pursuing it. You don't pursue it, you give up on it. You don't have a desire for it. So that's not how it works. Catechism says, since Christ died for all, and since all men are in fact called to one and the same destiny, which is divine, we must hold that the Holy Spirit offers to all the possibility of being made partakers in a way known to God of the Paschal mystery. What's the Paschal mystery? Paschal is lamb, Pasch, lamb. It's Jesus, the Passover. The Paschal mystery is the death and resurrection of Christ. Last Supper, Good Friday, Easter. So it has to be possible for anybody that's ever existed to get to heaven. Somebody in North America in 34 AD, no possibility of hearing about Jesus, it has to at least be possible to get to heaven. Because God wills all men be saved. That's in the scriptures. God, it has to be possible. Otherwise, God would have created people destining them for hell, which we don't believe. So this is what the church says. Every man who is ignorant of the gospel of Christ and of his church. So they're ignorant. They don't know any better. They didn't turn their mind off like some people do today. Oh, I could have listened at church, but nope. That's we call vincible ignorance. That's your choice. You're choosing to be ignorant. You didn't. You know, people are saying, "Hey, I'm gonna teach you," and they're like, "Sorry, that ain't gonna get you into heaven." That type of ignorance. No, they're ignorant. They have no way of knowing of the gospel of Christ and His church, but they are seeking the truth and doing the will of God in accordance with their understanding of it. So they may have this much of the truth, and they're being faithful to that much. They don't even know. They're ignorant. They don't even know all this other stuff yet. No possibility. They can be saved. It may be supposed that such persons would have desired baptism explicitly had they known of its necessity or even existence. So a person in 34 AD, North America, 40 AD, 100 AD, 1000 AD, God's going to look to their soul and say, okay, the only way you're going to get to heaven is because of what my son did on the cross. But you have no possibility of knowing about him yet. So are you following the truths that you could know? All right, I'm going to make you a partaker of this grace because there's no way you could have heard about him yet. Not for, 1,400 years. As regards children who have died without baptism, the church can only entrust them to the mercy of God as she does in her funeral rites for them. Indeed, the great mercy of God, who desires that all men should be saved, and Jesus' tenderness towards children, which caused him to say, let the children come to me and do not hinder them, allows us to hope that there is a way of salvation for children who have died without baptism. All the more urgent is the church's call not to prevent little children coming to Christ through the gift of holy baptism. When should a child be baptized? As soon as it's born, man. Some places in the world, they're baptized next day, as soon as they can get that baby out of the hospital. It doesn't have to be the next day, but it shouldn't be like, maybe when they're 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 or 6. No. That's going to affect that child. They're living without the grace of salvation in their soul for years. That's going to affect them. Do we want them to be temples of the Holy Spirit, or do we want them to be empty chalices? Okay, so what is needed? Salvation and the life of grace. Faith. sanctifying grace, baptism. We're also going to talk about the Eucharist being necessary because Jesus said so. The Catholic Church, staying out of mortal sin, going to confession if we committed mortal sin, persevering in charity. This is the life of grace. This is what Christ wants us to have as the core of our lives, right? Well, isn't this just earning your salvation? This all these works you have to do? No, this is grace, 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 grace. It's all grace. God wishes to give us life, right? It's a reminder that this is a new way of living. Yeah, maybe someone, you know, dies right after their baptism. They're never able to go to communion or confession. Okay, whatever. But once we receive the grace of salvation, he wants us to walk in it. He wants us, it's not just, okay, I'm good. I got baptized. There's a danger right now in our culture that there's a lot of people that say this idea that, oh, I made my sacraments. I'm done. I'm good. Just because you make your sacraments doesn't mean you can still go to hell. You can still go to hell. You miss one Sunday Mass. Look at pornography once. Have sex outside of marriage once. That's it. Just because we make our sacraments doesn't mean that we're saved and that's it. We can't go to hell. No. You've been given all this grace, then you have to actually be faithful to it. It's a relationship. But there's this mindset that parents all hear this, like, my kid made their sacraments. I'm done. I'm a good parent. No, you're not. Your kid left the church. Your kid doesn't even go to Mass. You failed. I don't know. Can't judge all parents, you know, as kids leave the church, but like my kid made the sacraments. I did my job. No, that doesn't mean you did your job. Can a kid even tell me what a sacrament is? Can he even name the seven sacraments? Like we gotta change that mindset because massive amounts of people are leaving the church because they don't know anything about the church. They made their sacraments, they got confirmed, and then left because it was just empty to them. It wasn't a way of life. And I was unfortunately the same way. I thought to myself, once I get confirmed, I don't have to go to the classes anymore. I had this mentality that confirmation is graduation out of the church. I'm done. I'm good. I did what I was supposed to do. No, it's an entrance. That's like saying, I'm done. I got married. I don't need to see them again. I don't need to talk to them again. I got married. That'd be crazy. We are not a minimalistic religion. This is a way of life. Okay, so how do we speak of salvation? Okay, we need salvation. All have sinned and are deprived of the glory of God. We are like empty chalices. Jesus Christ is the only Savior of the world. We must believe in Him. We must be in a life-giving relationship with Him. Again, it's not just a feeling. I feel, I care. Okay, but has Christ actually brought the grace of salvation to you? Because sometimes we have strong feelings because we're selfish, right? I love God so much. No, you just love yourself, and God's just your pillow. You know, it's like something, you know, just because we have an emotion doesn't mean we have faith. Sometimes people just use people. Jesus gives us life through his body, the church. But we got to stay on the vine. We're the branches. He's the vine. We got to stay connected. So that's baptism connects us. The Eucharist strengthens us. Reconciliation restores us if we've broken ourselves off the vine. And we must persevere in sanctifying grace. We have to maintain that grace dwelling in our souls. Okay. So, confirmation. We're going to talk more about confirmation, but just a little bit here. In Acts chapter 2, after Jesus ascended into heaven, he told his apostles to pray for the coming of the Holy Spirit. And in Acts chapter 2, the Holy Spirit descends upon the apostles, upon Mary and the disciples, as flames of fire. And they start speaking in different languages, speaking in tongues. And all these people from all these different areas who spoke different languages all heard them speaking in their own language. And so what we say is confirmation is a participation in the grace of Pentecost. The grace of Pentecost comes to our soul in confirmation. And we see a distinction between baptism and confirmation in Acts chapter 8. We see these two ways, these two levels maybe, of receiving the Holy Spirit, right? We become temples of the Holy Spirit at baptism, but we talk about confirmation bringing the Holy Spirit too. So this is where we see it. Now, when the apostles at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent to them Peter and John, who came down and prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit. for it had not yet fallen on any of them, but they had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then they laid their hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. So they see baptism, but there's some way that they haven't received the Holy Spirit. And so the apostles, what do? They pray. They put their hands on their head. They pray. And the Holy Spirit comes down upon them. Hence the sacrament of confirmation. So the sacrament of confirmation is receiving the grace of Pentecost into our soul. Another way of saying it is a greater capacity to receive grace and to live by the gifts of the Holy Spirit. So I like to think of it as, you know, baptism is putting all the wiring in so that the light can come on in the house. Confirmation is strengthening that wire, making it a stronger gauge so that light can go even brighter. All right, difference between maybe lights and high beams. Same capacity, right, that grace in us, gifts of the Holy Spirit, but we're strengthened. The gifts of the Holy Spirit are wisdom, understanding, counsel, fortitude, knowledge, piety, and fear of the Lord. And we're going to talk more about these in the future. These gifts, these graces that God gives to the soul at baptism strengthens in confirmation. So confirmation, this is the shortest summary, says, what is confirmation? Confirmation perfects baptismal grace. Three words. What does confirmation do? Perfects baptismal grace. What is original sin? The loss of sanctifying grace, being born without sanctifying grace. What does confirmation do? It perfects baptismal grace. It takes everything of baptism and strengthens it. Gives us the Holy Spirit. Roots us more deeply in the divine filiation. Roots us more deeply in our identity as children of God. Incorporates us more firmly into Christ. Strengthens our bond with the church. Associates us more closely with her mission. And helps us bear witness to Christ. Witness to the Christian faith in words accompanied by deeds. And I think this is an important one. It associates us more closely with our mission. Sometimes we think of baptism, you know, as okay, it's the sacrament we receive in it as infants. Makes us children of God. Confirmation is the strengthening of all those graces so that we can go out and witness to our faith. We can stand up and say, I believe. Even if it means getting my head chopped off, I believe. It gives us that grace that strengthens us. And we're part of that mission. In the old rite of confirmation, the bishop would give you a little slap. Not very hard, but a little wake up. Like, you're a soldier for Christ now. You have a mission. And again, for 2,000 years, a vast amount of those, people were losing their head for following Christ. And there's still today people being killed for being Catholic. So that's all in the catechism. So confirmation, who can be confirmed? Any baptized Catholic not yet confirmed? Can't be confirmed multiple times. But confirmation is, again, it changes your soul. It's an indelible mark. Who can confirm? A bishop is the ordinary one, just like because the bishops are successors to the apostles, right? Or a priest with permission. Priests can get delegated. So for example, here, confirmation, it's going to be Father Hector. How's the sacrament celebrated? The bishop or the priest that has the permission anoints the forehead of the baptized. There's the laying on of hands with the sacred chrism saying, be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit. That's what happens. He doesn't go, I'm just going. No. Right, and again, we have these promises. The same promises of baptism that we have at confirmation because it's strengthening all of that. So those who are already baptized can be like, yeah, this is the time. Do you believe this? Maybe your parents professed that faith for you when you were young. And every Sunday you stood up and professed. But now it's going to be like, do you really? You really embrace this? You willing to take this on? So confirmation is not us confirming our faith. We do that every day. We're supposed to do that every day. Every time we go to Mass, we confirm our faith. Confirmation is a confirming, a making firm of your soul so that you can receive more grace to live out. All right. We don't really have time for questions, so I'm going to close with a prayer. Then I want to make some announcements, okay? So let's pray. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So, Lord God, thank you for the gift of the sacraments so that we can know that we are receiving these graces into our souls. Help us to believe. Help us to love you. Help us to be faithful to you. Help us to turn away from anything that's contrary to what you're calling us to live. We ask all this through Christ our Lord. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.